Hello, I'm Dr. Leslie Citrome, clinical professor of psychiatry and behavioral sciences at New York Medical College in Valhalla, New York. All patients in the study had schizophrenia. They were all experiencing an acute exacerbation of their schizophrenia, and they were enrolled in a clinical trial of lumateperone, and lumateperone was compared versus placebo. Two of the trials included risperidone as an active control. So this study actually pooled together three different clinical trials to determine the overall efficacy and tolerability profile of lumateperone. The reason why lumateperone was examined was that it's the newest second-generation antipsychotic to become available, and as such, we don't have much experience with it. So the more we know about it from the clinical trials, the better off we'll be in understanding its potential use in our patients with schizophrenia. It's important to take a look at the clinical trial effect sizes. So that's the difference observed between the test drug and placebo on a number of different measures, including reduction of symptoms. It's one thing that a drug is better than placebo and that we know it's statistically significantly better. It's another thing to look at the size of the treatment effect. So number needed to treat and number needed to harm are effect sizes that allow us to actually estimate the drug's potential usefulness in day-to-day clinical work. The likelihood to be helped or harmed is actually the ratio of number needed to harm to number needed to treat, and gives us information about how likely it is to experience a benefit compared to a harm. The results indicated that for people who were randomized to lumateperone, they were more likely to be responders than those randomized to placebo. The number needed to treat there was a single digit, which means it didn't take very many patients to be randomized to lumateperone instead of placebo before expecting to encounter one additional responder. When we look at various treatments for schizophrenia and other mental disorders, number needed to treat values less than 10 when compared with placebo generally denote a drug that is useful and can be employed on a day-to-day basis in our practice. We have to remember that placebo is not no treatment. People who received placebo in these clinical trials actually received care in a structured setting. They actually got assessments on a regular basis, may have gotten PRN medication, and also were paid for their participation. So it's no surprise that people on placebo would get better. And that's actually, you know, quite common. The expectation of a benefit is there when you participate in a trial. It's called the placebo effect. So the effect of the drug has to be larger than the effect with placebo. And if a number needed to treat value is less than 10 under those circumstances, then we generally think that this is a useful intervention. We can actually do very similar analyses with other second-generation antipsychotics, whether they be oral or long-acting. However, the trials have to be similar enough. So for acute trials, where you enroll patients who are acutely exacerbated and you measure the change in, let's say, the positive-negative syndrome scale total score over time, if these trials are similar enough, then you can calculate the NNTs for each one and then compare indirectly these treatments. The common denominator, actually, is placebo. All these medicines have been compared with placebo. So how do they fare versus placebo? Actually, pretty similarly. And that's the bottom line with the second generation of antipsychotics. They actually perform reasonably well versus placebo with similar number needed to treat values. However, they do differ in terms of their tolerability profile. This is how we often decide, along with our patients, which course to go. Some people are more sensitive or concerned about issues such as weight gain or akathisia or sedation. And all our different choices have actually different profiles regarding these kinds of adverse effects. So we can take a look at the number needed to harm, for example, and take a look at which medicine is more likely to be associated with weight gain or sedation or akathisia and choose accordingly. Lumateperone evidenced really very nice results when it came to looking at weight gain or akathisia. Very little in the way of weight gain in excess of 7% from baseline, and no akathisia to speak of. However, it is associated with some degree of sedation or somnolence. No drug is perfect, of course, but it's good that we have different drugs with different tolerability profiles so we can match the right drug with the right patient. Tardive dyskinesia is an adverse effect that takes a while before it becomes observable. patients have to be on a medicine for a lengthy period of time in many cases before tardive dyskinesia becomes apparent. Now, it is known that second-generation antipsychotics are less likely to cause tardive dyskinesia than older agents, but the risk is not zero. In favor of lumateperone is the absence of motoric adverse events acutely, which bodes well for a better tolerability profile long-term in terms of tardive dyskinesia. But lumateperone still has affinity to the postsynaptic D2 receptor in the dorsal striatum, and that's where we believe is the genesis of tardive dyskinesia. So I don't think we're entirely out of the woods, but it looks pretty good when compared with some other agents from our past. We have to remember that lumateperone is a branded second-generation antipsychotic, so it's not likely to be the first antipsychotic to be offered to an individual person with schizophrenia. More likely than not, they'll have been treated with a generic second-generation antipsychotic. And should that not be tolerable for that individual, we can turn to other agents, such as lumateperone, for a better experience for that individual. For example, if someone is concerned about weight gain or concerned about akathisia, lumateperone actually is very suitable for such a patient. However, if a patient is more concerned about sedation or somnolence, then maybe not. So this is the usefulness of calculating number needed to harm for our different second-generation antipsychotics. We can actually see which one would be best suited for an individual person based on their individual values and preferences. The bottom line is they all work, and they all work pretty well. It's just their tolerability can differ. And a word of caution here, individual patients will have individual propensities to develop various side effects, and no two patients are the same, and it's somewhat unpredictable, but it's nice to be able to offer something that is different to someone who tells us about their prior experiences and what they would rather avoid. In general, long-acting injectable antipsychotics, I think, are preferred, and for the simple reason is that we no longer have to guess whether someone is taking their medicine or not, so that's convenient for us. But it's also convenient for the individual with the illness. They don't have to remember to take a pill every day, and they're not reminded every day of taking a pill that they're ill, basically. People can feel fine and then feel reluctant or have some uneasiness about taking a medicine for which they don't see any reason to take. So this happens with all disorders, not just psychiatric. Someone with hypertension or diabetes may feel fine. They may feel they don't need the medicine that day. And so compliance or adherence is actually a problem for those disorders as well. For schizophrenia, it's a problem on another level as well, because there may be actually a fluctuating level of insight that pervades the illness. So patients may actually, as part of their illness, have little insight into their symptoms. But when they come to see me in the office, they do so voluntarily. They are able to talk about their experiences, and at that time in the office are able to express an interest in receiving treatment. So wouldn't it be simpler to offer that treatment in the office, and then the patient doesn't have to worry about it till the next visit? I'm really excited about two new ways of treating schizophrenia. They do not involve postsynaptic dopamine D2 blockade in the striatum. That's how all antipsychotics for the past 70 years have essentially worked. These new mechanisms of action involve muscarinic agonism for one of the agents and tracheamine receptor agonism for the other agent I'm thinking about. Both are really different mechanisms, and yet they appear to treat the symptoms of schizophrenia as evidenced in published studies in the New England Journal of Medicine. So should they be successful in their phase 3 clinical trial development programs, then they'll be available for our use in the not-too-distant future. This has tantalizing prospects for actually eliminating the risk of tardive dyskinesia, something that only occurs when you have drugs that bind the D2 receptor. So if we can avoid that, we can avoid TD perhaps. And these two new mechanisms may also avoid the metabolic adverse effects that we've been stymied with. They also avoid elevations in prolactin. They also would avoid QTC prolongation. So in many respects, they look like they're better tolerated agents in terms of the traditional adverse events that we've been concerned about. And should they prove to work well in people with schizophrenia, I think they'll be widely adopted. I think we are in a very exciting era of medication development for a variety of disorders, including schizophrenia. I think the challenge will be to how to interpret the clinical trial results in a clinically relevant manner. I think number needed to treat and number needed to harm help place these medicines into clinical perspective. By understanding the effect sizes of the proposed treatments, we can better apply this information in the day-to-day treatment of our patients.